On Larry King Now, the biggest name in comics, Stan Lee. What makes a good superhero?
They have to have flaws, because even, I hate to say this, but even I am flawed. Everybody is flawed.
You, Stan?
I know, it's hard to believe. Joni said to me, if you want to quit before you do, write one book the way you'd like to do it. The worst that can happen is he'll fire you and you want to quit anyway. And that's when I did the Fantastic Four.
Plus,
all of our superheroes mostly have been American. So we want to get a Chinese one. We're also working on an Indian one, Chakra. I'm working on, I can't announce it yet, but I'm working on a Latino superhero.
All next on Larry King Now. Welcome to Larry King Now. He is one of my all-time favorite people. He's Stan Lee, the man who changed the face of comic books. He's co-creator of some of the world's favorite superheroes, Spider-Man, Iron Man, The Incredible Hulk, The Fantastic Four, Daredevil, X-Men. The list goes on and on. Stan is Chairman Emeritus of Marvel and a member of the editorial board of Marvel Comics. He's the founder, chairman, and CEO of POW Entertainment. His latest project is Stan Lee's Mighty Seven, in which he has a starring role, his first ever. Mighty Seven premieres February 1st on the Hub Network at 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 Pacific, before we do anything else. In Iron Man 2, you played me. Why didn't you have me play me?
Well, because then they might have wanted you to play me, and you'd never have done that. It was easy to play you. All I had to do was wear a pair of suspenders, and everybody said, hey, isn't that Larry King?
All the cameos you have in Marvel Comics, you choose them?
No, I have nothing to do with them. As a matter of fact, I go to the studio, they send for me, and they say, here, put this on, get out in front of the camera and do whatever the director tells you. Now, one of the funniest things about that is, one day I walked there, I was wearing a white shirt, pair of jeans, white sneakers, and I walked into wardrobe. She said, well, you'll need a white shirt, a pair of jeans and sneakers. I said, great. She said, so try these on. I said, but I'm wearing them. No, no, you've got to wear ours. I had to take mine off, which were comfortable and beautiful and fit perfectly. I had to put on the studio's outfit, and then they spent a half hour pinning it to make it look as good as what I had worn walking in.
That's Hollywood, Stan.
That's doing cameos.
Kids are growing up with iPads and whatnots and everything that's changed. Has the world changed in your realm?
The world changes for me every day. Like, I didn't know I'd be being interviewed by Larry King until a short time ago, and this is a hell of a big change. But no, everything is a change. I mean, you take our characters. We could never have put these movies on the screen and let them be the hits that they were years ago. It's all because of the ability to do these special effects.
So you like technology?
Oh, I love it.
You started as a guy drawing comics in a comic book.
That's right. Well, when I was doing the comics, to me, that was technology. We were making little drawings, and somehow or other, they appeared on a printed page in full color. That was technology.
Who was your comic book hero as a kid?
My comic book hero was Flash Gordon.
I love Flash.
Oh, yeah.
I also like the Black Terror.
I don't remember him.
Oh, I like
Batman. He was a villain, I'm guessing.
Yeah, I like Batman better than Superman.
Yeah. Oh, well, Batman had more character.
That's right, he didn't fly.
Yeah.
Okay. What makes a good superhero?
Oh, golly. He has to be unique. He has to be different. He has to be empathetic. You have to care about him, and he has to have a weakness. If one of the problems with Superman for me and for the company that owned Superman was that he had no weakness. They had to invent Krypton just to get something that would make you worry about when he was fighting somebody.
You're famous for, you give them flaws, right? You like your superheroes to have some flaws, some.
They have to have flaws because even, I hate to say this, but even I am flawed. Everybody is flawed.
You, Stan?
I know, it's hard to believe.
What do you make of the real life superhero squads that have popped up? Down in San Diego, there's a real life superhero community.
Well, I hope they don't get hurt because they don't really have superpower and they go around dressed up and as superheroes and looking for situations. So I just hope, as I say, that they don't sometimes get involved in something they can't handle.
I love my comic books. My kids are 14 and 13, and I don't remember them reading comic books when they were 7 and 8. What, are comic books still around?
Yeah, they're still around.
Are they as big as they were or not?
I don't think so. I think there's too much else. When comic books were big, there was no internet, there were no computers, there were no movies with special effects. See, comic books, the superhero comic books, were really like fairy tales for grown-ups. Because if you think about it, when you were a kid, even you, I'll bet you love fairy tales, stories of giants and wizards and witches and monsters,
yeah.
Of course. You get a little older, you're too old for fairy tales. Then you discover these comic books. It's the same thing. You have characters that are bigger than life and scarier than life. So you can recapture that old feeling you had when you were a kid.
I miss that. I miss serials in the movies where you had to go next week to see what happened to the hero. 13
weeks. I love them.
So many comic books have been turned into movies. Are writers today aware of that? Is it a different world?
Writers today are different than the comic book writers. Comic book writers in my time were people who were starting out as writers. And some of them made it, some of them didn't. Today, comic books have become so important to writers that they get the top writers in America and the world writing comics because the writer feels, if I write a good one, this is going to turn into a movie and I'll be involved.
What's the secret in a good comic?
Well, it's the
brevity.
It's the same secret as with any good story. I'm not sure. It isn't mostly brevity. It's the idea you have to care about the hero. As in any story, you have to worry about him. You have to wonder, how is he going to get out of this?
Is all of what we're talking about male-oriented?
Mostly. Mostly it is, because most of the audience for this type of story is male. However, it's beginning to change. Believe it or not, Iron Man has caused most of the change because women are just mad about Robert Downey Jr. and his portrayal of Iron Man. And because of that, they're now tuning in to more and more of this type of movie. Then you have a movie like Captain America. They love Captain America.
Oh, yeah. That was a great movie.
Yeah.
What keeps you going? We're
going
to talk about your new venture in the next segment, but you're 91 now, right?
Yeah. Oh, you should have seen me when I was 89, when I was a spark plug.
Oh, you were a killer then. When we come back, we're talking with Stan Lee, who, like me, has had his fair share of movie cameos over the years. When we come back, why he decided to take on a starring role of his own. Has he lost it? Has he become egomaniacal? Stay with us.
Sounds like a new villain. Whoa, take it easy. I'm one of the good guys.
Shut up, ancient one.
Let him go.
Drop the weapon or I laser his head right off his neck.
Hey, I know it's a little gray on the outside, but I still need what's on the inside.
That was a clip from Stan Lee's Mighty Seven. Who drew Stan Lee?
I don't know, one of the animators.
Did a great job.
Well, anybody who makes me not look like a freak, I figure, does a great job.
All right,
but I didn't realize, listening to it, I was wonderful. I didn't know I was that good. Man, I stole the show.
91, your first starring role. Why now?
No, I had one before that.
What?
Years ago, there was a movie called Mallrats. Remember that?
Mallrats.
Yeah, and I had a starring role.
You described it as the world's first reality comic book and animated series. Explain that to me.
Well, you know, reality television shows are so big now. I like to get on a bandwagon whenever I can find one. And I felt if we're going to do a cartoon, an animated movie for the Hub Network, I want to make it more different than anything before. Why not make it a reality animated cartoon? So in order to make it a reality cartoon, we have real people in it. I'm as real as I know I can get. So I'm in it. We have a few other real people in it.
You got Jim Belushi is in it.
Jim Belushi.
Christian Slater.
They're doing the voices, right?
Terry Hatcher. Sean Astin. Armie Hammer's in it. Flea and Darren Criss, they're all voicing superheroes. Are the superheroes
Absolutely.
New heroes?
They're all new heroes. Actually, they're aliens from another planet, which is not unusual in a superhero story.
You've got other new diverse superheroes coming. Annihilator, Chakra, Chinese,
Annihilator,
Indian, right?
Annihilator is a a movie we're doing together with a Chinese production company. And he is a Chinese superhero, but it's not a Chinese movie. It's like Spider-Man or Iron Man or any other. It's a typical Stan Lee superhero movie that features the Annihilator.
Ethnic superheroes, is that new?
Well, we want to, all of our superheroes mostly have been American, so we want to get a Chinese one. We're also working on an Indian one, Chakra.
Right.
And I'm working on, I can't announce it yet, but I'm working on a Latino superhero. We have a black one, Marvel has, called the Black Panther, which will be a movie pretty soon.
Why not a Latino?
Pardon me? Like,
why haven't we had a Latino?
That's what I'm working on.
I know,
on now.
Why not?
Absolutely.
You would think, well, that's late, isn't it?
See, the thing is, normally when I would sit down to write about a superhero, I think of a normal American one, because I'm American and I'm surrounded by, you know, in this country. But lately I've been thinking we've got to be more worldwide. So we're starting with a Chinese, Indian, Latino, and then we'll keep going.
Is the audience always constantly coming aboard? Their new kids get a little older and they become attracted to
superheroes,
right?
Oh, yes. If you do a good movie, a good television series, anything good, you'll get the audience. There's never a chance to worry. People want entertainment. People want adventure stories. They just want them to be good.
Now, your name is synonymous with Marvel. Do you have any creative control over Iron Man, Fantastic Four, The Avengers?
None at all.
Does that
and that's
bug
the
you?
Way I like it. These
Why
people,
do you like it?
They know what they're doing. They're the best in the business. We get the best directors, screenwriters, actors, and so forth. All I do is sit back, take a lot of credit, and that's just fine.
And make money.
Well.
Do you get paid for everything that happens around?
No, I don't. No.
Why not?
Well, it's not part of my deal.
They're your heroes, though.
Well, I created them, but that's okay.
Wait a minute. I thought the creator always...
The company treats me fine. When I created these, I was a writer for hire. And I got paid a salary, and everything I wrote belonged to the company. And that's fine with me. The company has treated me very well.
How did you get famous? What made us know Stan Lee? Why do I know Stan Lee? And that's who I know in comic books.
I'd like to think because I'm such a wonderful television guest. But other than that...
No, why you?
What I did was I signed my name and the artist's name on every story that we did. So any story would say by Stan Lee and Jack Kirby, by Stan Lee and John Buscema, by Stan Lee and Steve Ditko and John Romita and on and on. So I guess if people read enough books and saw my name and all of them, they got to know me. And then I tried to personalize our comic books. Instead of just the stories, I wrote little messages. I had a column called Stan's Soapbox, where I would just talk to the readers, not even necessarily about comics, anything that came to mind. I was like a literary Alan, what's your name again? Larry King, like a...
Do you think this has kept you young, this life you lead?
Maybe. It's kept me energetic, certainly, because I love what I do, and I can't wait to wake up the next morning and do another story
Do you write with young people in mind?
No. No. I write with myself in mind.
What's it like when you see one of your creations come to life? You created Iron Man, and then you see Robert Downey.
Oh,
well, that must be
magnificent.
A hoot. That must be a hoot for you.
It is. It really is. And as I say, without any help from me, they are creating such beautiful movies, producing the greatest. I mean, I love seeing these movies, just like any typical fan.
We're looking forward to Stan Lee's Mighty Seven. It premieres February 1st on the Hub Network, 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. When we come back, he's the most popular 91-year-old on the planet. We'll trace the early days of Stan Lee, back when he was cavorting around with Lincoln and those guys. Don't go away. We're back with Stan Lee's. Looking forward to Stan Lee's Mighty Seven. You're 91. You don't look at you feel 91. What's it like to feel 91?
I don't know. I hope I never find out.
Do you fear death?
I don't fear death. I'm curious. I can't imagine what it could be like. Because I personally feel when you die, that's the end. It's like
Me
a
too.
Machine that the engine is off.
I think that's it.
But how can there be nothing forever? You know what I mean?
Forever. It's hard to imagine.
I can't believe it.
To not exist.
Yeah, so I almost can't wait to find out, but I'm not in a big rush.
You wanted to be a serious writer. How did you get into comics?
Well, I needed a job.
And where was this? New York?
This was in New York, yes. I applied. There was a publishing company, and a cousin of mine ran it, and I heard that there was an opening there. And they published mystery books, girly books, sport books, all kind of books. And they also had a little comic book line. And I didn't know where they needed the assistant. It happened to be in the comic book line. So I was hired by Joe Simon and Jack Kirby, and I was supposed to fill the ink wells. You know, they used ink in those days, and run down and buy him a sandwich and do proofreading, things like that. After a while, Joe and Jack left. I was the only guy left in the department, and I was about 17 and a half. And the publisher came in and said, Stan, can you run things until I find a grown-up? Well, when you're 17 and a half, what do you know? I said, sure, I'll handle it. And he must have forgotten to look for a grown-up, because I stayed there ever since. I became the head writer, the editor, and the art director.
You were known in World War II as the playwright, right?
Yeah, I worked in a group that did training films and instructional manuals for the troops. And William Saroyan was there, and there were a lot of big-name Hollywood people were there. I was like the token nobody in that group.
How did Spider-Man come about?
I needed a superhero. I had done the Fantastic Four and the X-Men, and my publisher said, hey, they're doing well, do another one. So I came up with Spider-Man, and I said to him, I got this great idea. I want to call him Spider-Man, and he's a teenager. So I gave him the idea, and he said, Stan, that is the worst idea I have ever heard. He said, first of all, people hate spiders. You can't call a hero Spider-Man. Secondly, he said, he can't be a teenager. Teenagers are only sidekicks. And finally, he can't have personal problems. Don't you know what a superhero is? So he wouldn't let me do it. One day we had a book we were going to kill called Amazing Fantasy. When you're going to do the last issue, nobody cares what you put in it. Just to get it out of my system, I put Spider-Man in the book. And we sold it, and it was a bestseller. So my publisher called me in a couple weeks later. He said, Stan, you remember that character, Spider-Man, that you and I liked so much? Why don't you do a series of it? And that's how Spidey was born.
How did you come up with the name Peter Parker? Is that you?
No. Peter Parker with a PP. I have bad memory for names, so I try to give every one of my characters the same first letter as last letter. So if I remembered one of them, it would give me a clue to what the other name was.
Do you see any danger in violence, video games, juvenile delinquency, that whole thing which used to be said about comic books?
You know, I really don't, because I've been exposed to all that sort of thing, and everybody I know has been. And we don't run out and commit violent crimes. I think people can tell the difference between a story and real life.
Of your characters, who would you choose to protect you from evil?
Any one of them. They're all great.
Who would be your best friend?
Probably Spider-Man. No, but and I think Iron Man. Iron Man is my type of guy.
Who you want to have a beer with?
Iron Man.
Who would you like to date your daughter?
Captain America.
If Larry King were a superpower, what would my power be?
A voice.
Ah.
I have a character with a voice that is a superpower, actually.
Was there ever a time you thought about quitting the business?
Yes, just before I did the Fantastic Four. I said to my wife, I'm sick of doing these kind of stories, because at that time, my publisher said, don't worry about characterization, don't worry about plot, just give me a lot of action. That's what the kids want, action. And I was giving them a lot of action. I said, I want to write a story, not just all that nonsense. So Joni said to me, if you want to quit before you do, write one book the way you'd like to do it. The worst that can happen is he'll fire you and you want to quit anyway. And that's when I did the Fantastic Four. Luckily, it sold, so then I was able to do the books my way.
Speaking of that, your wife, Joan, it's been 65 years, huh?
66. We're no newcomers to this.
How does she put up with you?
Oh, she's lucky as hell. I'm the most amusing guy I know.
Does she like all the work you do? Is she into it?
No, she's not really a comic book reader. That's why we get along so well. She does her thing, I do my thing. She's more talented than I am. One day she said to me, Stan, get me some paper. I want to write a novel. I said, you've never written anything. She said, no, I want to write a novel. She wrote something called The Pleasure Palace, submitted it to Dell. It became their lead paperback seller of that month. First book she ever wrote. Never wrote another one because she got busy with other things.
Is it a sexy book?
Oh, yeah, very sexy. Very sexy. That's my wife.
Did she write about you in the Pleasure Palace?
No. Well, I imagined I was every one of the characters. But she could have been anything. She was an actress, a model, a singer, and a dancer when I met her. And I said the stupidest thing a man could ever say to a woman. I wanted to sound macho, so I said to her, "No wife of mine is going to work." And she said, "Okay." And she could have been supporting me all these years.
We have things in common. We're both Jews. Both come from New York. Both poor. Does your success, mine surprises me. Does it surprise you?
Oh, yes.
You pinch yourself?
Yeah, all the time.
Yeah, me too. You dreamed of writing the great American novel, didn't you?
I did years ago. That's why I changed my name to Stan Lee. I didn't want to use my real name for these silly comic books. But then I became known more for the comics as anything, so I legally changed my name to Stan Lee.
What was it?
My name was Stanley Martin Lieber, a real normal name.
Nice. That sounds like a Pulitzer Prize winner.
Yeah. In fact, I used to write a signature Stanley Martin Lieber as if I imagined someday it would be a famous name.
Stan will take some of your many questions in our final segment right after this. We're back with the great Stan Lee. It's a word that applies to him. Stan Lee's Mighty Seven will premiere on the Hub Network on February 1st. We have some social media questions for you. Amante Stunt AM tweets, do you have a favorite movie version of a hero?
Yeah, one of the things I loved, you wouldn't remember, you're too young. There was a movie called The Scarlet Pimpernel with Leslie Howard.
I remember the movie.
And I loved the book. And that movie was wonderful. That he was like the first real superhero that I read about.
Mark Webster on Facebook writes, great artists such as Jack Kirby or Frank Frazetta have very recognizable styles. How much does the art or artist's style impact the writer's ability to tell the story?
Well, it isn't the artist's style as much as the artist's ability to tell the story. Every good comic book artist would make a good Hollywood director, because when they draw a panel, they have to decide what is the best angle, what is the most dramatic way to show it. And it just depends on how they can interpret something. Their style, all of them have good styles. It's more their interpretation than their style that counts.
At King BJ Nation via Twitter, is God a common theme and inspiration in Marvel comic books?
I don't think so. I don't think people are considering that much. I wrote a poem called God Woke. If anybody wants to Google it, they may get a kick out of that.
But
God Woke. But as far as the comic books themselves, I think the writers are too busy trying to come up with a good villain who can trap the hero and how will the hero get out of it. That's mostly what they're thinking of.
At Joan V212 wants to know, what do you think of the Big Bang Theory? The show has reopened the world of comic books.
I think it's wonderful, especially since they gave me a role in one of them, and it was a very popular role.
At Espolita 18 tweets, what is one superhero you regret approving to be made?
None of them. None. I love them all.
At Fred Felton tweets, will they make a Wolverine, X-Men, Avengers, Spider-Man, Fantastic Four crossover mega movie?
Someday when Marvel gets all the rights to them, unfortunately, legally, some other studios have the rights to some of the characters, but they'll all come together sooner or later.
At Revro Feeble 23 wants to know what your favorite non-Marvel related movie is.
Non-Marvel? Oh, I have so many favorite movies. Inherit the Wind, On the Waterfront, The Quiet Man with John Wayne, millions of them, King Kong.
We're going to play a little game called If You Only Knew. A character that didn't take off that you wish had.
Well, I had a villain once called Diablo. I thought the name was great.
I love that.
But I didn't know what to do with him. Jack Kirby and I had to do a story very quickly. I said, here's the villain, Diablo, and he's such and such. But I didn't give it much thought. The book came out, it was all right, but I never knew who Diablo really was, and I never used him again.
First person you kissed?
A girl named Martha.
Martha.
Yeah, I belonged to a little dramatic group when I was a teenager.
In Brooklyn?
Actually, it was in the Bronx.
The Bronx.
And she was a member of the dramatic group, and we were playing a little role. I was only about 15 years old, and I had to kiss her, and it was nice.
Favorite TV cartoon?
Cartoons? The Simpsons, no doubt about it. What I've done two roles in it.
Yeah, me too. I've had a lot of fun. What keeps you up at night? What worries you?
Whether I'll be able to come up with a good story tomorrow.
Technology you refuse to wrap your head around. Is there a technology that you don't want?
No, I wrap my head around all of it. I love it. My only problem is I don't see as well as I used to, and it's hard for me to read the little type on some of these iPhones and so forth. But I love technology.
If you weren't a comics tycoon, what would you be?
Probably unemployed. I don't know. I'd love to have been an actor, actually. And I'd like to have been an advertising man. I love advertising. I treated Marvel halfway as if it was an advertising campaign with expressions like, "Welcome to the Marvel age of comics. Make mine Marvel."
Was Marvel based on Captain Marvel?
No, not at all. It was just a name I thought would
be good. Was Captain Marvel a Marvel comic?
No. We called ourselves Marvel Comics. And somehow or other, we got the rights to the name Captain Marvel. And when DC wanted to do Captain Marvel, they had to call it, not Captain Marvel, I forget what they called. What was the name he used to become Captain Marvel?
Shazam.
They called it Shazam, I believe.
I remember Shazam, the favorite decade of your life.
Right now, I guess.
Last time someone called you Stanley Lieber.
When I was about 14 years old.
Character you wish were real?
Oh, any superhero. They're all wonderful. I wish they were all real. We'd have a great world.
Anything you regret?
Yeah, that this interview isn't longer. I'm having a good time.
Greatest accomplishment?
Probably the comic books I came up with.
What superpower would you like?
The superpower I would like to have, this may surprise you, I think the greatest superpower in the world would be luck. Because just imagine, if you were lucky, nothing would go wrong. Guy takes a shot at you, it misses.
How about the power to be invisible?
Yeah, it's all right, but I wouldn't know what to do with it, except spy on women. There you go.
Thanks to my guest, the great Stan the Man Lee. Stan Lee's Mighty 7 premieres February 1st on the Hub Network. And remember, you can find me on Twitter at King's Things. I'll see you next time.